welcome back. Let's go over the wiki for Antonio Nardello. He was an Italian serial killer who robbed and murdered three men in Maryland and Washington, D.C. between 1884 and 1885. He was convicted of one murder and was sentenced to death and subsequently executed in 1886. So today I'll be narrating the details they have on Wikipedia concerning this old ass case, because again, it's pretty interesting and pretty bizarre at the same time. So here are the details. They stated concerning his early life that he was born in Naples, Italy. At the time of his birth, his father was imprisoned for 20 years and Antonio never saw him. In 1883, he immigrated to the United States, working at various times in New York, Chicago, and finally in Cecil County, Maryland, where he was employed as a laborer by the Baltimore and Ohio Railroad. Now, that all sounds fine and all, but of course, he immigrated there in 1883, and a couple years later, he was already executed by the state. Pretty bizarre if you look into someone's future in that manner. First, he seems all innocent, and then, a few years later, the own country that he's living in will execute him for doing vulgar, unspeakable crimes. So this is what they wrote concerning the murders. On April 1st, 1884, aiming to rob a fellow laborer along the Philadelphia Road in Gunpowder, Maryland, Nardello killed a man named Brosnan, known by his nickname, the Blacksmith. Another employee, Giuliano, was erroneously convicted of the crime and sentenced to 10 years imprisonment. He was exonerated only after Antonio confessed to the crime shortly before his execution 2 years later. So somebody was already wrongfully convicted. Sadly, this happens even in this day and age. Though it's, I wonder on a scale of 1 to 10 how many cases are wrongfully convicted. It's absolutely disgusting that it happens. Usually it's because the law enforcement have a certain pressure to solve a case and then they just want to pinpoint it on someone that seems a suspect when he's not. Pretty gruesome and pretty messed up. Now, the next victim that they have documented here stated the following. On May 19th, 1885, a laborer named Charles Bushell was searching for a stray cow near a Cecil County homestead when he accidentally discovered the body of a man on a hill, partially covered with leaves and hidden in a bush. The right side of his skull had been crushed, and judging by the advanced state of decay of the flesh on his face and hands, he had been murdered upwards of months prior. No valuables were found on the body, only a ticket from the Philadelphia, Wilmington and Baltimore railroad line between Wilmington, Delaware and Chester, Pennsylvania, and a letter written in Italian, dated November 1st, 1884, and addressed to a man named Antonio Sabini. An autopsy of the body concluded that he had died from blunt force trauma, likely inflicted with a club or cane, but no positive identification of the deceased could be ascertained. It was speculated that the victim had been an employee of the Baltimore and Ohio Railroad, and when the authorities questioned the workers, they claimed most of them suspected a fellow countryman, one Antonio Nardello, might have been the killer, but he had left for Baltimore in December 1884. With no clues leading to the identity of either victim or killer, the deceased's remains were buried and the case faded into obscurity. The truth was revealed on the day of Nardello's execution, when he confessed to the murder of a fellow railroad worker, Antonio the Balbo. In his testimony, he had boarded at the victim's home and knew that Balbo had cash on him, and on December 19, 1884, he asked him to accompany him on a walk. While the Balbo was distracted, Antonio pulled out a gun and shot him, taking his watch and money, which he later sold in Baltimore, before concealing the body in the bushes. Although there were discrepancies in his confession, key among them being that the Balbo had been shot instead of bludgeoned to death, the authorities still considered his confession credible based on the circumstances and officially closed the case. Now, that wasn't the only victim. The next one they had documented stated the following. On August 1st, 1885, citizens living close a newly built reservoir near Howard University in Washington, D.C., lodged complaints about a foul smell emanating from an old abandoned shack in the farm of Curtis Gilbert. When they entered one of the rooms on the second floor, they discovered a decomposing body of a man laying on the floor. At his glance, nothing suspicious about his death was noted, until the officers noticed the huge gash on his neck, as well as blood splattered on the floor and walls. Not long after, the descendant was identified as a middle-aged Italian immigrant named Carmine Rutuno, a laborer and shoemaker who lived at a nearby boarding house. He was last seen on the early morning of July 29th, accompanied by one Antonio Nardello, another laborer with a reputation for being a lazy man who preferred to spend his money and time gambling. Despite warnings from his co-workers, he accompanied Nardello as the latter had promised him work and was never seen alive again. Pretty gruesome, pretty disturbing, but of course they were able to arrest this guy, and these are the details they have documented concerning what happened. The very same day, authorities tracked down Nardello to a house on Maryland Avenue, where he had been staying with a woman named Willa Morrow, under the pseudonym Frank Rosso. Both were arrested at the Baltimore and Potomac Depot, where they were due to catch a train to Baltimore. When examining the room occupied by Morrow, police found bloodied clothing, which they ascertained belonged to Nardello. Due to him violently resisting arrest and threatening suicide, he was shackled and sent off to jail. In the subsequent interviews, he admitted that he had participated in the murder and that a bloody razor found at the scene belonged to him, but claimed to have had two accomplices, Pascal Gazzamonte and Pascal Abidante. According to Nardello, the three allured Rotuno to the house with him and Gazzamonte holding the victim down while Abidante cut his throat. They then stole $150 from his pocket, of which Antonio received a meager $30. No evidence implicating the two men could be found, and soon he was put on trial for the murder. On October 10, 1885, Antonio was officially indicted for Rotuno's murder, with a Frank Mancosis sworn in as his interpreter, as Nardello couldn't speak or understand English well. Initially, due to the news spreading about the crime, the court had difficulty picking out juries, as a majority of them had formed an opinion based on what they read from the newspapers. During the trial, one of Nardello's attorneys, Corkill, received a letter of gratitude from Italian minister Baron de Vava for defending Nardello. After the trial resumed, more than 200 witnesses were brought to testify at the trial, chief among them being Carmine Gaudio, at whose house Rotuno had lodged in. In his translated testimony, he noted that Rotuno had visited him several times on the day of his disappearance to buy beer, and although he hadn't seen Nardello, he knew that the blood-stained pants found at Morrow's house were his. Antonio continued to insist that he had an accomplice in the murder, knowing full well that he would be hung, but demanded that Gazzamonte and Abidante be executed as well. Disregarding his wishes, on December 12, 1885, he was found guilty of the murder and sentenced to death. Initially appearing unfazed, he wept bitterly on his way to jail. About a month after the sentencing, his attorneys filed a motion for a new trial, citing new evidence that would prove that their client was innocent. They had received a letter from a friend of Nardello who claimed he could provide witnesses that will indicate where Antonio was, and even named them, but in the end the motion was denied. While residing on death row, Nardello turned towards religion and wrote letters to newspapers in his home country, as well as sending copies of his photographs to relatives in Italy. Much to his pleasant surprise, on May 5th, he was granted a three-week reprieve by President Grover Cleveland, but after it passed, Nardello was informed that his sentence wouldn't be commuted, and the execution would proceed as planned. The day before his execution, he confessed to his priests that he had murdered Rotuno and the two men in Maryland. After explaining in detail what he had done, he walked to the scaffold, uttering prayers loudly in Italian and reaffirming his innocence. When the drop was sprung, Nardello slowly suffocated, and in 9 minutes and a half, his pulse completely ceased. And that's the end of the article on Wiki. It's almost like a poetic way of how they ended this. Crazy story. It's like, his pulse completely ceased, man. Then there was silence. And then suddenly God opened up heaven for him and took him in, and now he's enjoying paradise. Imagine that. I know not many people are like that for serial killers, but you know, you gotta understand, God probably has a sense of humor about all of this in his own ways. Regardless, this case, amongst others, doesn't sound nearly as crazy as some of them, but it's crazy enough because we're dealing with someone that did kill people in cold blood for money. He just had the desire to get money, take it through violence. Happens all the time in this day and age as well, so nothing new there. But it was one of those historical cases that was pretty interesting, especially as I stated at the intro somewhere, that the fact that he only lived in America for a few years and then got executed by America itself is just so bizarre. But I guess that's what's gonna happen if you decide to break the law and start murdering people over there. So at least I'll keep that in mind to make sure that I won't ever do that. Anyways, with that being said, dear viewer, have sweet dreams.